Thank you everyone for coming. How often do you ask questions these days? How often? As students in universities, we are conditioned to answer questions, right? We don't ask many questions. Today, I will share you about the experience of mine with the questions why and why not. When did we ask questions freely? When you were a child, right? That boy was me. And standing next to me is my mother. My favorite pastime activity is to ask questions to my mother. For everything, I ask her, why? When she try explaining things to me and get tired, I don't want to end the conversation, I ask, why not? So one time, most of my questions doesn't have any sense. One time I asked a very important question that stayed with me for the rest of my life. I had a bug as a pet. I was playing with that bug in a backyard. And I got sick, but the bug did not get sick. So I asked her, why I got sick and why not bugs get sick? So she said, maybe you should grow up and find out the answer by yourself. Because I was so, felt very low, because is my immune system that much weaker than a bug? It's so small, right? I went on to do PhD in this topic, and I came to know that bacteria can be used actually as a pesticide, as a chemical alternative to kill the insects that can damage the crops. I'm not going to talk about that. When I was doing this research, I came to have this question. Do bacteria get sick? Now I have Google with me. So they do, I know. We are so different from bacteria, insect, right? But we all have four things in common in all of us. Can anyone say? We are all made from letters. A, T, G, C. A for A49, T for thymine, G for guanine, C for cytosine. Where are these letters in our body? Probably you all know about this molecule, DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. So these molecules are arranged as a pair on the double helical structure. Yes, bacteria, pest, that's my daughter, on her head, Sakura, everyone have ATGC. If so, why do we look so different? We all have the same kind of letters, right? Then why do we look so different? It's all about packaging. DNA, when stretched out, is about 2 meters long. You can't even see the cell with your naked eye, right? You need a microscope to see. And nucleus is about 6 micrometers, very small. How do the DNA, shown in blue, gets packaged into the nucleus? As you see, they get wound around the protein, shown in yellow, called histone protein, and make a structure called chromatin, and get inside and store in the nucleus, the part of the cell that stores the DNA. It's getting too technical? Imagine. I said, DNA or nothing but letters. Imagine that you have a big sheet of paper and you see this ancient scrolls, right? These days you can see in the souvenir shop where they put the map in that. You can roll those sheets, right? So chromatin is a structure that resembles this ancient scroll. We can actually pack the information, that the instruction script, that is the gene, inside the nucleus by scrolling the letters inside our body. Each pack have a meaning. And they may switch on and switch off the gene. This is how the switched off gene look like. It's simple. At the molecular level, if you see, can you read any letters ATGC there? Not in the chromatin, not in the analogy, the ancient scroll, right? This is the off gene, because you can't see. Same way, the natural copy machine goes by the name RNA polymerase, also cannot see. What is the on gene? The opposite. Can you see now? the letters ADGC? You can see, same way the copy machine see, and they go and make a copy of a script that contains the information for cellular function. So this is on gene and this is off gene. What causes on gene and what causes off gene? There are some lock marks and unlock marks on the protein. What caused that? Can we open the lock? To answer that, I want to ask you a question. I told you I like asking questions. You see two bees here. One is a queen bee, other is a worker bee. Can you identify the queen bee? Yeah, that's right. I bet few of you know that when they started their life as babies in the form of larva, they look the same. But one went on to become big as a queen bee, the other worker. Why? The answer lies in the diet. There is a strange rule in the bee world that one set of larvae get chosen and fed with the diet containing the royal jelly. Royal jelly contains a secret ingredient. It's nothing but a chemical. That chemical acts as the molecular key and goes and unlocks the good genes, the queen genes, and make them bigger, healthier, and make them live longer. This is the case with insects. How about we, humans? We don't care about bees, right? Same situation. So be careful with your diet. Not just your diet, your environment, the air you inhale, your stress levels, and all the factors that is above these letters A, T, G, C can make marks on your body. You have to be careful because these marks can not only affect your health, but can also affect generations, until three generations. You don't want to get scolded by your grandchildren, right? These days they're very informed. They will say, my grandfather did this. Right? So have a happy, healthy lifestyle. What if you already screwed up your system or you got something from your grandfather? Don't worry, we always have alternative. Scientists have been working hard to develop the molecular keys. They identify the molecular keys from nature, from everywhere, from plant to the microorganisms and everywhere. These keys are amazing. Some of them are so powerful that they can open up the anti-disease gene. But they have a problem. They can't read letters. Imagine this to be the letters inside the disease cell. What happened? Sometime they may end up unlocking and switching on the gene that is not supposed to be disturbed. Sometime they may unlock the gene that can cause side effect. So this is a problem for using this kind of synthetic keys for the elderly patients, pregnant women, and babies. In most cases, these are the people who need this kind of treatment, right? So what is the solution? Where is the answer? The answer always lies in the nature. Let me introduce you to this molecule which I'm working on now. Pyrrole imidazole polyamide, we call it as PIP. This was discovered by Professor Peter Derwin from bacteria. Bacteria do not have organs. How do they speak? How do they communicate? They communicate by releasing the chemicals. Professor Peter Derwin hacked one of the interacting chemicals with the bacteria, and he found that these two molecules, pyrrole and imidazole, can read the letters ATGC. Now to make it simple, just remember P and I. P and I, when paired, can read ATGC. I and P can read GC, P and I can read CG, and P and P can read AT or TA. These molecules can enter the nucleus and localize themselves to the target sequence. Here in iCeMS, we focus on inventing things and integrate things. I joined iCeMS in 2010 with Professor Hiroshi Sugiyama, and I got attracted to this why not question by him. As I told, synthetic keys can open, cannot target. The DNA reader can target, cannot open. Why not integrate them both? Make it powerful, a hybrid key, a designer key that can both target and open. We did that, and we wanted to know the power of this molecule, so we tested them in the human skin cell, our skin tissue, because this is one of the places where most of the genes are hidden. One of the keys activated and switched on the genes that can fight cancer. The other key did not touch the anti-cancer gene, but activated the reproductive cell genes. This is so cool because meiotic pathway, the reproductive pathway, is very much locked inside the human skin cell. Imagine getting a sperm out of a skin. And one of the key switched on the retinal cell genes. And we wanted to know, can we try this to regenerate the tissues and organs? For the first time, we want to know whether we can use it for the stem cell technology. Stem cells are very powerful because we humans do not have the capacity to regenerate the lost body parts. So what we did is we were able to make a script and target the stem cell instruction script. We were able to make the on-hot script. What you see is the microscopic image of the beating heart cell generated using our designer key. We were also able to switch on the brain program and make the brain cells. This is good, but I want to tell you one of the work which is very close to my heart. This is my daughter. What goes around comes around, right? Now she asks me questions for everything. Why? Then when I explain, she asks, why not? Only now I realize that I troubled my mother. At that time I thought it was good asking questions. So what I do, I give her an iPad to shut her off. But iPad gives so much information to her, and she ends up asking more questions now. I don't know what to do. So she asked me, what do you do so long in the lab? I say, to make it simple, I make switches which can switch on and switch off the genes inside the cell. And it seems that she saw some video in YouTube. You know, these days they make lot kind of simple videos with illustrations, right? So they say a very nice song, the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, something like that. Then she came to me and asked, you said you are making switches, right? I said, yes. Does it work in the powerhouse of the cell? I said, no. If it is a switch, if it's not working in the powerhouse of the cell, what is the use? I said, okay. I said, like, you know, DNA usually gets stored in the nucleus, right? But that's not entirely true. There are some part of DNA which is also stored in the mitochondria. In fact, many of the letters in mitochondria is known to be associated with the aging process for diseases, very rare genetic disorders. You know, a lot of incurable disorders is now associated with the mitochondria. So, but it's not so easy. It's like Mission Impossible. Because mitochondria is like a miniature fortress which have charge outside. It cannot allow any of the external chemicals to enter inside. It also have a barrier. It's not so easy to do that. We are not Tom Cruise, but we made a chemical Tom Cruise. What we did is we added the positive charge to that, and we were able to give the hydrophobicity to cross the lipid membrane, and we created the first ever small molecule that can enter mitochondria, read the DNA letters in it, and switch off the disease-causing gene. So this work got well recognized all over the world. And one of the peers who actually worked in developing this DNA reader with Professor Peter Durbin, Joel Gottesfield, so he wrote a nice article in CNN News where he said, this paper brought a big smile on my face because this is something I never thought of. How can I say to him that this is not what I thought of, my daughter thought of? Probably he will laugh more when he hears the whole story. But let me remind you, all the work that I have presented today is done only in the lab scale. And we need to make them to enter the clinic. For that, today, I would like to remind myself and you to ask more why and why not. Why gives you the answers, but those answers could also have been seen by others. While why not can make you to create facts and discover some new stuff and unleash the new possibilities. Thank you very much.